Behind them and listen to what they have to say. And tonight, Lord, I pray that this debate will be one that will be thrilling to each and every one of us that are here tonight. And it's in the precious name of Jesus, the risen Christ our Lord, that I do thank you. Amen.
Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. I will be moderating our debate tonight. Our contestants, our first speaker will be Senator Jack Murphy. Our second speaker of the evening will be Michael Williams. Is that better? Worse?
Yeah, well,
better?
No, it's not on.
It's not on at all?
One second.
We can fix that.
No, Jay.
How about now?
Okay, there you go.
All right. Very good. So our first speaker will be Senator Jack Murphy. Our second speaker will be Michael Williams. And I do ask that all participating at this point turn off cell phones and any electronic devices. Timekeeper will be sitting in the middle of the aisle. It is none other than our state college Republican chairman, Will Kremer. And with that, we're going to be off to our opening statements. Senator Murphy.
Thank you, Adam. I think Commissioner Amos just walked in, back in the back. He didn't just got here. I just want to recognize him. First of all, let me thank everyone for coming out tonight to be at the debate. It just shows that you're interested in what's happening in this county, what's happening in this state, and moreover, what's happening in this country. For anybody to come out at 7 o'clock in the evening and be at a function like this tells a lot about the ones that are here, and I really do appreciate it. Let me just give you some background. I've served in the legislature 12 years. I started serving in the House of Representatives. I was elected to the House of Representatives 2 terms, and then I was elected to the Senate, and I've been in the Senate for 4 terms. During my term in the Senate, I have signed on to at least 113 pieces of legislation. One of the most recent pieces of legislation that was passed, it just went into effect a few days ago, is the voting legislation that requires young people to be trained before they're operating a boat or jet skis, and that was a result of an accident that killed 2 young people at Lake Lanier, and Senator Miller and I were the co-sponsors of that bill. Also, I serve on the Rules Committee. I serve on the Appropriations Committee. I've been on Appropriations for 9 years. I serve as chairman of the Regulated Industries and Utilities Committee, and I'm also serving on Public Safety. I was chairman of Public Safety at one time when I first went into the Senate. It's been a pleasure to do what I can for Forsyth County, to do what I can for the state, and we'd like to continue doing that and would appreciate your support in doing that. Thank you.
Michael Williams.
I too like to thank all of you for coming out, Brad and the Forsyth County GOP for putting this on. Also, I want to thank my family, my wife. I always get a little too
volume.
I apologize. I want to thank everybody, particularly my family. My wife is here. She has been my biggest supporter. There's no way I could have done this without you, sweetheart, without your love. Thank you so much, Virginia. My kids, Em and Jared and Courtney, they're all here. They spent their spring breaks, their summers out there knocking on doors, helping me. Thank you guys. I also have my brother, his wife, and my sister, her 2 kids here as well. Thank you guys. And all of you for being here. Jack said, it's a testament of your involvement, but I also know that you're not here to see me. You're here to see that this guy here showed up. So Jack, thank you for being here. Thank you for participating in this. Like I said from the very beginning, this race is personal to me. I am tired of feeling like me and my family are not represented. And instead, the special interests of small groups that have different political ties, that their needs and interests are more important than ours. I feel like it's time that the citizens of Forsyth County have a state senator that's going to represent them 100% of the time, not 2 or 3 weeks before the election when they finally show up for a debate or they send a letter or attend a board of commissioner meetings asking for a specific zoning request to be denied. So thank you.
We did draw lots before the debate began, and the first question will go to Senator Murphy. Questions will range from the economy to budget to taxes to transportation, education. So I think everyone here should enjoy the rest of the evening. We'll start with the economy. Georgia was recently named the number one state for doing business and the number one most competitive state by Site Selection Magazine. Ms. Murphy, in your opinion, what are the most important factors that enabled Georgia to become more competitive?
Well, one of the most important factors is that we offer a lot of tax incentives that we have passed in the legislature, especially for manufacturers. Tax incentives, we passed tax incentives with Delta Airlines. We passed a lot of things for the Caterpillar place down in Athens. We passed a lot of incentives to draw business into the area, which draws employment, which is very important to us. Employment in Georgia, that's one thing that's helped us grow with the economy. We're still lagging behind in Georgia in the economics as far as the economy goes, but we're coming up slow, but we're coming up, and we're improving things. Forsyth County, we're fortunate in Forsyth County to be one of the best-run counties in the state with the best per capita income in the state. So all of that, combining all that with the governor's help of bringing business in here and industry, has helped our economy and helped us to be named number one in the United States for economic growth.
Thank you.
I completely disagree with that. I feel like the reason that we were ranked number one on Site Magazine is the $250,000 that our governor gave Site Magazine in advertisements and endorsements. I think that recommendation was bought and paid for. As far as all the companies that Senator Murphy has spoken about that he brought or participated in bringing here, I do not feel like incentives to these big businesses are needed. I think that's corporate welfare. What I think is needed is we need to create an environment that's equal for everybody, every single one of us to go out there to start our own business if we want to. We need entrepreneurs here in this state, not big businesses. I would much rather have hundreds of thousands of individuals out there working hard day in and day out than a few select companies that receive tax breaks on our backs. So there's much more we can do here in the state of Georgia to be more competitive.
Remind both candidates, you do have 1 minute rebuttals for any question that you choose.
Let me say something to Michael's response on that. Number one, I don't appreciate you hitting our governor. I think he's done a good job about bringing business into this state and improving the economy. The second thing I want to say is that we're a state senate position. We're not a federal position. So a lot of this has to do with the federal, and I'm the only candidate that's endorsed in this race by the National Federation of Independent Business. I'm the only candidate in this race that is endorsed by the Georgia Chamber of Commerce, which helps to bring economy and business into this state. So, I mean, I just can't see where he's coming from on his answer.
Yeah, Jack, I'd like to tell you that I will stand up to whoever I need to, whenever I need to. If it's the governor, if it's the lieutenant governor, if it's not what's best for the state, then I will stand up for them. And you've also mentioned that our state is doing better. 2 years ago, when you were up here debating Moschel, you quoted our unemployment rate of 6.9%. Our unemployment rate has actually gone up to 7.2% under your tutelage. And then also, during your original 2 minutes, you were talking about how you brought all this stuff to our state, and then you go and blame it on the federal government. I think we need some accountability here.
we have more economic questions. And also the good news is they led into my next question. According to the U.S. Department of Labor, and this next question will start off with Michael Williams. According to the U.S. Department of Labor statistics, Georgia's unemployment rate peaked at 10.4% in December of 2009, and it has fallen to a low of 7.0% as of April, and he is correct, it did rise to 7.2% as of May. The national unemployment rate for the same time period fell to 6.3% as of April. Well, as Republicans, we know the government does not produce jobs, but in your opinion, what should be done to improve the unemployment rate in Georgia? Michael Williams.
All right, well, as I mentioned before, I feel like one of the most important things is creating an even playing field for every single one of us. One of those things I think would help that is to eliminate the state income tax. We need a fair tax. The state of Georgia needs to be competitive amongst the southern states. Florida already has a fair tax. I'm sorry, no income tax. Texas, Tennessee, and North Carolina is going that way. The state of Georgia's state income tax is higher than Illinois. That's absurd to me. We need to, like I said, make it so that people can come in, can invest. I think doing that would help out tremendously. Also, deregulation. A business needs to be able to come in, know that they can operate and not be interfered by the government. One of the reasons I sold my business, I had 18 locations, I support those haircuts, was Obamacare. The regulations that are continuing to put on small businesses hinder innovation. So that's it. Thank you.
Same question, Murphy.
Well, let me say that I agree that we do need a consumption tax, but more importantly, in getting rid of the income tax, a lot of people just think, well, we can just get rid of these taxes, we can get rid of property taxes. We have to have something to replace it. And we need a fair tax or a consumption tax. I completely agree with this. As a matter of fact, Congressman Linda, when I was his finance chairman in Forsyth County, I've got a book that he gave me that says to my first family of Forsyth County, signed by John Linder and also by Neil Boortz. I supported the fair tax forever, and we need it. But we've got to find a way to do that. We've got to be able to get a way to implement it. More importantly, I'd like to see us do away with the property taxes, which affects more of us in tax burdens than the income tax. And I don't know if, you know, I'm not going to get into this, but there's a question. Well, I'm just not going to say that. Anyway, that's my answer.
Do you need a rebuttal?
I want a rebuttal, yes. Senator Murphy, I appreciate your response, but again, 2 years ago, you sat up here and said almost the exact same thing. I'm a big supporter of the fair tax, and property tax is so bad we need to do something about it. But what have you done about it the past 2 years?
I have signed on to every piece of legislation that has come through to relieve us from tax burdens. Every resolution, every national resolution submitted to the federal government, every state resolution, you can look up my voting record and see that I've signed on every piece of legislation to do that. I've discussed it with the governor. I've discussed alternatives with the governor. I mean, I've done everything I can. My question is, you know, you weren't here 2 years ago. So, you know, I've done a lot.
Again, the good news is there's more tax questions. they will have an opportunity to continue. As conservatives, these are the questions that are on our mind, and so that's why we're going to hit some of these. It'll seem a little repetitive. The next question goes to Senator Murphy. How does Georgia compare to our neighbor states when it comes to taxes? What tax reductions have you supported in the last couple of years, and what tax reductions would you support specifically going forward?
Well, as we just said, I would support a fair tax, a consumption tax, as soon as we can get it going and get it down the road, to replace the property taxes and then replace the income tax. But let's be fair here. We can't just do away with taxes and not have a replacement. We have to have something to run the government. We can't have anarchy. We've got to have something to run the government. So I would support any of that and have supported it, and have supported a reduction in property taxes and the assessments. I signed on to two different bills that has to do with capping assessments in the state. When they come out and do an assessment on you, once they have done the assessment, they can't raise your assessment for another 3 years, you know, statewide. So I've signed on to several pieces of that legislation, and I'd have to go back. I mean, this legislation has been, you know, brought forth in the last 8 years, and there's so much of it that, you know, but you can look at my voting record, and you can find, you go on the voting record, go on the website to the Georgia.gov, pull me up, find my voting record on every piece of legislation that I voted for. Matter of fact, if you want to look at it, I've got the 113 pieces here that I've signed on to. And when I say I've signed on to, that means I was either the sponsor or co-sponsor of that sponsor. That was the first four signers of the bill.
Well, first of all, to answer your question, how do we relate to other states around us? Getting in the Southeast, we have Florida, we have Texas, we have Tennessee and North Carolina that all have or are working on a no state income tax. Also, Georgia is ranked 18th in overall tax burden. Tennessee, Alabama, and South Carolina are lower than us. And according to the Tax Foundation, Georgia ranks 32nd in the business tax climate index. So we have a lot of work to do. I appreciate, again, what Senator Murphy's talked about, signing on and trying to move stuff forward. But again, we need more done now, today. What I keep hearing is things he said 2 years ago, and nothing has changed. I'm not promoting anarchy. I'm not promoting that we don't know that we do away with taxes altogether. But we need to do something. We need to go down there and actually fight more to be heard. We need these changes. We need it now.
There's 236 legislators down there, and there's the governor. Now, you're one among many. Everybody, you know, every candidate that comes in is going to run. They're always going to change the world. But let me tell you, the rubber meets the road when you sit down in that desk and you have to punch a green or a red button, just like these commissioners do up here. So that's when it really means something. Florida has the highest, have you been and purchased any gasoline in Florida? You know, what is it, about $4.63, $4.90 a gallon? Have you paid any taxes, property taxes, in Florida? A 1,500 square foot condo in Florida is $6,700 a year in taxes. I mean, yeah, we got some taxes in this state, but I think you do, when you start comparing that, you need to compare apples to apples, not apples to oranges.
Moving on. Sticking with the budget, but taking the other side of the coin, given the tight budget constraints facing Georgia, and this question would go to Mr. Murphy, would next. Given tight budget constraints facing Georgia, what are your top priorities for reducing spending? Please give specific programs or costs that you think need to be cut.
Well, the main thing that we've done over the last, we have reduced our spending in 2006, 2007, we had $17 billion budget. Before that, we had a $21 billion budget. We're back to our same per capita spending as we were in 2000. Now look at our population increase, and look at what our per capita spending is today. It's the same. We've done a great job in handling the budget. That's the only thing that we're required to do in the legislature is to balance the budget every year. And what I propose to do is we're back up to $21 billion, by the way. So what I propose to do and think we need to do is learn a lesson from what we just went through over the last 4 or 5 years. And let's look at areas that we were spending money where we didn't need to spend money. And let's look at those areas. Let's look at how we're handling our welfare. Let's look at how we're handling, we've already looked at the Medicaid. The governor has refused to go along with the Obama Medicaid requirement because it's going to wind up costing us $2 or $3 billion. We can't afford that in a state. We've got to continue to look for ways to improve our service, but not increase our debt. Our budget, 52% of our budget goes to education, 46% goes to K through 12, and the other amount goes to college. Then 30% of that budget goes to public safety and Medicaid. That leaves us only 18, 19% to work with all these agencies and everybody coming in with their hands out. We've just got to be very careful about how we spend the money and learn a lesson from what we just went through about the expense of the expenditures we were making.
Just hearing him talk about a $17 billion or a $21 billion budget, I am so sick and tired of being lied to. That is the amount of money that the state brings in, but that is not the amount of money that the state spends. The state spends close to $39 to $40 billion. So that is the true budget. When I talk about a balanced budget, I want to know every single dollar that's coming in and every single dollar that's going out. Yes, it's a state center responsibility to balance that budget, but let's be honest about it, call it what it is. It's $40 billion, half of which we're getting from the federal government. That is not acceptable to me. Some things that we can do, well, first of all, I'm interested in some specifics. If I remember or my notes right, we're spending $12 million on a Braves parking lot. We don't need to do that. Well, why is the government, why are our tax dollars going to a Braves parking lot? They can pay for their own parking lot. Also, zero-based budgeting. I would love to see us go to a zero-based budgeting where every single department has to account for and support the dollars they're spending. I think those things can help out a lot with our budget.
That's sent to us to take care of these different areas, you know, within our budget, within the $21 billion. If you'd like to expand on that, I'd like to see the figures on that, Mike.
Well, I apologize, Jack. I expect the state senator to know our budget. I didn't bring a copy of it with me, but you can go to the governor's website. He has it on there.
Well, since it's 2 inches thick, I didn't bring it with me either.
Well, you're asking for it.
Well, gentlemen, you're the one giving the
anyway.
Gentlemen, gentlemen.
Budget.
Plenty of time. Let's let's not go back and forth.
You have no questions on the budget, or is this it?
You're still in the box.
We have more questions about the budget coming?
No.
Okay. Also, this budget that we're talking about, this is only an operating budget. It's not even talking about the money that we spend in capital investments. Our state is $11 billion in debt for capital investments. Thank you.
Can I rebut that? How do we maintain a AAA bond rating with all that debt? I mean, we've only one of eight states who has a AAA bond rating. Still, through all the recession, through all the losses, through everything, we still have a AAA bond rating. If we had that much debt, was carrying that much debt, which is about $156 per individual in this state, $156 compared to about $14,000 per individual in the United States.
I'm going to have to give Michael a minute.
Let's just keep strapping our kids with debt.
Jeff. We will now be moving on to transportation, but transportation does have to do with the economy. The next question will go to Michael Williams. In your opinion, does Georgia currently spend enough money on transportation to meet our state's growing population? If not, what additional sources of revenue would you support?
No, I feel like the state of Georgia needs more tax dollars when it comes to roads. I don't feel like we need to pay more. I feel like we need to get more tax dollars from the federal government. The state of Georgia is a donor state when it comes to tax dollars for roads. So we need to work with our U.S. senators and our U.S. representatives to get more of our own money back so we can build our own roads.
We were a donor state up to about 3 or 4 years ago, and the federal government has been taking money out of their trust account and sending it back to Georgia. We've been sending about 92% of our funds up there, and we've been getting 100% back. Some states have been getting back more than 100% out of the trust account. That just expired on July 1st. You know, when you say you don't support taxes out of one side of your mouth, but then you say the federal government needs to give us more money, you know, I think we pay federal taxes. I mean, taxes is taxes. Whether you get it from the federal government or whether you get it from the state government, it's still a tax. We need to figure out a way to improve our transportation funding in this state. And there's ways to do it, and there's ways being worked on right now that I'm not liberty to say, but there's ways to do that. And we're going to have to do it to improve our roads. We brought in over $500 million in road funding in Forsyth County. Now, you know, over the past 10 years, $500 million, a lot of that has went to the improvements on 20, a lot has been went to the improvements on 141, a lot has went to interchanges. You know, it's there, you know, but we still need more. We've got to have more. We've got to improve 400. We've got to do something with 400 because it's hurting us economically if we don't improve 400. And that's one of my primary projects is to try to find out what we can do and convince the governor to take care of 400.
All right, first of all, I'm not asking for increased taxes. I'm asking for the money that we're already taxed on to come back to us. We don't need more of the federal's phony money. As far as the money that Jack's saying that we've gotten back from the county, he's saying $500 million today. There was a mail that was sent out a couple months ago that said $600 million. 2 years ago, we talked about it being $298 million. What the number is, I don't know. But he also talked about $400 being a priority of his 2 years ago, and it still stops at the county line.
Is what the money was. I said over 500, and I think the mailers I've sent out have said 500 in all the mailers we've sent out.
May 21st, 2012, go YouTube it.
One rebuttal, please. I know we did an extra one earlier, but we'll try to keep some more. But you know, when folks are this passionate about their state and their county, it's going to come out, so I appreciate that. Will only have one rebuttal each. Sticking with transportation, and we'll bring it home a little bit closer here, is Forsyth County getting its fair share of state transportation funding? And I believe the first question goes to Mr. Murphy.
No, it's not. And I talked to the governor and the DOT many times about this. There needs to be a better funding formula than what there is. There is a formula out there that currently says that if you are in a high growth transportation area, you'll receive more funds. And that formula is based on something that was passed several years ago that needs to be improved. We don't need to be building roads down in Ocilla, Georgia. We don't need to be building super highways down, around Albany somewhere when there's two or three cars on the roads. We need transportation funding in the high growth areas, and not just Forsyth County, but there are other areas that's high growth, such as Forsyth County. I think we're still ranked about sixth in the nation for our growth. So that's where our funding needs to go. It needs to go to the areas that are having the infrastructure problems that we're having and the road problems that we're having. And that's one of the things I plan on doing, looking at and seeing if we can't change that funding formula within the state.
Traffic here in Forsyth County infuriates me. I've already mentioned how 400 stops just right inside the Forsyth County line. There's already talk in the city of Milton by expanding Highway 9 road improvements from Windward to guess where? The Forsyth County line. Cherokee County, they've already had funding to improve two of their intersections along Highway 20 where they were concerned about accidents. We're in Forsyth County, there are five intersections with almost three times the number of accidents as those two intersections. And there's no discussion, there's no money, there's nothing there for it. Do we need to change the way dollars are spent here in Georgia? Most definitely. However, that's something that I support. Senator Murphy over here again, 2 years ago, he said that we need to fix our traffic and we need to do it now. 2 years ago. He also mentioned that our traffic is keeping large companies from coming to Forsyth County, therefore preventing jobs for our residents. This was 2 years ago. We're still stuck in the same traffic. We need more things done and less talk.
During that 2 year period that you keep going back 2 years ago, we have completed a lot of road projects in the county, especially the completion of 141 and the completion of widening of 20. And we've had several interchanges, McFarland interchange. A lot of the interchanges have been improved around Forsyth County in the last 2 years. So it's not like we've just been sitting on our hands and not making these improvements we have. But we don't have the money to complete to complete what we're doing. And we need that. We're going to have to work on getting more money for the county. We're going to have to get more funding for the county. Now, I don't know. Maybe a freshman legislator can get that money. I don't know. I don't think so. But I'm going to work on getting it.
Now, some of that money, Castleberry Road, how much money has been spent on that it could be allocated to better roads here besides, again, Castleberry?
We are at the halfway point for our evening, and I am going to take us off of transportation and move us on to education. The future of our children are worth a few minutes of discussion here. First question will go to Michael Williams, correct? I messed up. I think the first question goes to Mike. I could be wrong, but if I'm wrong, that's where I'm going. According to the Governor's Office for Student Achievement, the average SAT score of 2013 Georgia Public High School graduates was 1434, 40 points lower than the national average of 1474. Both Georgia's average score and the national average score fell by 3 points since 2012. In your opinion, what more should be done to improve education in Georgia?
I think the biggest improvement that we need in our schools is the more involvement of parents. With our children need us by them doing their homework, helping them with their tests. They need us. We can implement all the programs that we want to. Without us being there, whether we're stuck in traffic or working or out, wherever it might be, my biggest hope is that we as parents go out there and spend more time with our kids. That's the answer, is parental involvement. Again, it's not government, it's parents' involvement.
Question is, with parents having to work two jobs and working in their families and all, trying to make a living, how are we going to get them more involved? That's the real tough question on that. One thing that we need to do, Forsyth County, they need to use Forsyth County as a model for the rest of the state in how we educate children. We spend about $7,300 per student here in the county on our students. And in Fulton County, they spend $14,000 per student. And you look at their education and where they stand as compared to where Forsyth County stands. Yeah, we need to do a lot more, but we need this. It's going to have to start with parents, but it's going to have to end with the teachers. The teachers have got to be better trained. We're going to have to, and money is not the problem. Our teachers we're ranked about 26 or 27, right in the middle of the United States for teacher salary. So it's not the money. I mean, if you look at the gap between the 14,000 and 7,000, it's not the money. We've got to make sure that our teachers are teaching what we want them to teach, what the Georgia curriculum needs to be. Not the federal government curriculum, but the Georgia curriculum. We need a Georgia. Curriculum. You can go ahead and call it the Georgia Common Core, whatever you want to call it. But we need to get out of the federal government and go to the federal government and tell us what to do with our students. They don't need to be telling Montana, they don't need to be telling California, and they don't need to be telling Georgia.
Moving on. Do you believe state or local funding should be used for charter schools or for vouchers? Why or why not? This question goes to Mr. Murphy.
I agree with charter schools. I think charter schools, I think that if we are paying $7,300 per student and somebody wants to put their child into a school, I think we need to give them $7,300 to let them do it. And there's a lot of school systems around the state to where the parents just don't feel like their child can get a proper education. You know, so why don't we allow those parents to put their child into a charter school? You know, and if they want to pay the difference, if they can pay the difference, whatever that county is being given per student, I think we need to give the parents the money and let them educate their child like they want to educate.
I have a similar opinion as well. I feel like our school system has a monopoly on the education of our children, and we need to do more to break that up. School choice, vouchers, whatever we can do to give parents, to get parent involvement, parent control over the education of their children. So whether again, it's vouchers, it's federal money, state money, whatever we need to do to break up that monopoly for more parent choice. Even homeschooling, I think homeschooling is a great thing as well.
Sticking with education, and since it was already brought up, this question will go to Michael Williams. From your perspective, please explain to the audience the good, the bad, and the ugly of Common Core and what should be done about it in the Georgia school system.
First of all, I don't believe in Common Core whatsoever. I think the ugly of it is they try to mask that they are not controlling the curriculum by saying that all they're doing is controlling the standards. Well, guys, if you set the standard, you're gonna also control what's being taught. So I think that's a false argument. Again, the government does not need, especially the federal government, does not need to tell us what our children are taught. We need control of what our parents, our local teachers and school board, local control. Again, I'm going to say it all night long when it comes to education. The parents are the answer to the education of our children. The more they're in control, the more they're involved, the more they have a say, the better off we're going to be. One of the things that frustrates me again with Common Core is no textbooks. I've sat down many times with Eamon and Jay trying to go over math homework or science homework, and I don't have a textbook to go back. I'm a pretty bright guy, but I can't remember all this stuff from years ago. So it's really challenging for me with no textbooks.
Something that one or two things that we maybe pick up from a federal, whatever their Common Core is, but we need to develop our own, just like other states need to develop theirs. It's just one side of it all. And then, you know, if it was up to me, I'd probably do it with the Federal Board of Education. School systems. We have a state school superintendent. We're just perfectly capable of developing our own curriculum.
Moving on away from education, but actually talking about something that's to the heart of what was just mentioned. And the question is not written to be flippant. So I apologize if anyone takes it this way. Does the 10th Amendment mean anything in the 21st century? What should be done to get the states back to their constitutional authority over powers that are not specifically granted to the federal government in our Constitution? I believe the first question goes to Jack,
I think so. To answer your question, does the 10th Amendment mean anything? No. It doesn't in the 21st century. It should, as part of our Constitution. This is our Constitution right here, the 10th Amendment in the Constitution. It says the rights belong to the people and to the states, but that right has been taken away by the federal government. Now, one thing we can do, which I've signed on to two constitutional amendments, convention of states, which requires a convention of states, and it's required by 34 states before it can be enacted to have a convention of states. And I signed on to both of them. One of them, the most important one to me, was to amend, under the convention of states, is to amend the how the federal government balances their budget. They need to balance their budget just like the state does. And that was the amendment, that was the constitutional convention that I signed on to just this last session. There was two of them sitting, and I signed on to both of them. You can go to the website and check that out, both resolutions.
The 10th Amendment should absolutely mean something in the 21st century. It is under attack. The states have lost a lot of their rights and sovereignty. Actually, let me restate that. They sold a lot of their rights to the federal government. We've already talked about our budget, but that's where in the budgeting process, when we get over half our funds from the federal government with strings attached, that's where we're losing this fight. We need to say no to the federal government. We need to get more of our money back and not going up there. As far as a balanced budget, I would love for the federal government to have a balanced budget, but again, not like the states do, because the states isn't really balanced. They need a true balanced budget. That's it.
I'd just like to see them balance something up there. They haven't had to balance the budget in the last 5 years.
We're going to continue on with some very important topics now to the Republican Party and the conservatives here in Georgia. First question will go to Michael. In your opinion, what is the most important pro-life step that Georgia could take in the next year, 2 years, and what will you do to make that happen?
I think the personhood bill would be a humongous step in the right direction. Granting rights at conception is extremely important, very near and dear to my heart. My family has been out on Highway 21 on prayer lines. I am pro-choice 100% of the way. So we need to do everything we can to protect the rights. I apologize so bad. I am pro-life. Yes. pro-life. And I'll help you fly right now.
I've been endorsed by the Georgia Right to Life ever since I've been in office, every single year. I think we need to do everything we can to protect the unborn. And I mean, the only way we can do it is keep pushing in the states. The award that was made in the Supreme Court the other day for Hobby Lobby was one of the most significant gains that's been made in the pro-life stance and protecting the unborn. All Hobby Lobby said was that we need to take, they agreed with I think 16 of the deals in there about the abortion pills, but they wanted the four taken out that actually caused abortion. And that's what the Supreme Court agreed with. They agreed with Hobby Lobby on that. I think that is a great victory for us. I think it's an absolute segue into maybe breaking the deadlock in Washington and at some point reversing Roe versus Wade.
Yeah, the Supreme Court actually used a bill that was passed. It was the Religious Freedom Restorations Act. And Georgia has a similar bill that has not been passed yet, but I would definitely support, and that's SB 377, the Preservation of Religious Freedom Act. As far as the endorsement that Jack Murphy has, the Right to Life, their executive director, also sent me an email basically explaining that they are not able to endorse a candidate if there's already an incumbent that has an endorsement. So while they could not endorse me, they did say that I was an advocate for the unborn. So that's just right below their endorsement.
Let me just say that Kim, if you check my voting record, there is always a number of like-to-like bills coming into the legislature. And every year, it's always divided right down party lines. We have huge debates on right-to-like. The Democrats, they want you to be able to do whatever you want to, and we want to protect the unborn. And I signed on to every piece of legislation that's ever been out there, including a lot of the late Representative Bobby Franklin when he was presenting the right-to-life bills.
Okay. We're going to move on to ethics. In light of, there was a couple of recent articles written ranking Georgia at the bottom in terms of ethics and ethics enforcement, would you support increased funding for the State Ethics and Transparency Commission? And this first question goes to Mr. Murphy.
I agree that we need to increase the funding of the Ethics Commission, but the first thing we need to do is straight out who's running that organization. Right now, we don't know who's running it. You can't get a straight answer from the Ethics Commission. We have like 169 cases of ethics complaints that haven't been heard yet, and they've been pending for a long time. We need to increase their funding. I think the governor proposes to increase their funding, but we've got to put some responsible people in there, and let's find out who's running the organization.
Yes, I agree with that as well. The State Ethics Commission definitely needs more funding. We also need real teeth in our ethic laws. There's legislation passed a couple of years ago that put a cap on how much money could be donated to an elected official. However, the onus of reporting that fell upon the lobbyist, not the elected official. So if somebody could give Senator Murphy $10,000, $100,000, however they wanted to, there's no responsibility for him to report that. It all falls on the lobbyist. I think that's wrong. I feel like our government kind of has it backwards. They're spending too much time governing us. They need to spend more time governing themselves.
I can't accept tens of thousands of dollars from anybody. The cap that we can accept and I have to report is $2,500 maximum going into the individual or our company. So I don't know where you got your information from, but I have to report that. And if you want to check my disclosure, it will be up on the website tomorrow. You can check any senator, you can check Michael's disclosure, you can check mine, you can see who gave the money to what. And there is a cap right now. There's a $75 cap on our spending. A lobbyist cannot spend more than $75 on us on any one occasion, like a lunch or a dinner or something like that. But that's the current cap that's in place.
On those disclosures that you may or may not go look at tomorrow, that's all on the honor system. There was no backup to that whatsoever. I could put on there whatever I wanted to, you could put on wherever you wanted to. No backup. I would like us to have to submit campaign bank statements to go along with our financial disclosures.
There is backup to it. I mean, it's illegal. You know, I'm not going to tell them.
Illegal is not backup.
And with that, you each had an extra. Despite my best efforts. But again, there's a lot of passion and a lot of care for our state up here, and that's what drives the energy. To change the subject, but only slightly, this first question will go to Mr. Williams. Would you vote in favor of term limits for all elected officials throughout Georgia, similar to the office of governor?
Yes, I would. I am 100% behind term limits. And I've actually sat down and spoken with people. There are four term limits, and also those that believe that term limits are the ballot box. If we lived in a world where the ballot box is actually on a level playing field, I would agree with that. Again, go back and look at those disclosures tomorrow, and you're going to see tens of thousands, if not hundreds of thousands of dollars donated to Jack Murphy. I think the last time we looked at it was like $67,000 that lobbyists and PACs donated to Senator Murphy over here. I believe 100% of the money that I have comes from either myself or local citizens.
It is extremely hard to beat an incumbent. Louis, 92% of all incumbents die in office. We need term limits.
Accept any campaign contributions from companies or lobbyists?
I know.
As far as term limits, we've got term limits right now. We've got term limits on July the 22nd in this county. You can vote me out of office, you can vote Michael in, or you can not vote for him, vote for me. That's term limits. But if we were to pass a four-year term, which we have proposed, we had legislation written, we had it last term, to where it would create four-year terms for senators, but of course the representatives want four-year terms too. 32 states have that. 32 states have four-year terms. And that way, you're not always campaigning, you're not always raising money, you're working for the people and working for the constituents. And I would support term limits if we went to that, so a 12-year term limit.
Term limits that went to 12 years. If I remember correctly, you said you've been in office for 12 years.
I wouldn't be running. And I would be glad to sign on the legislation that would support that and promise that I won't run if it's passed.
And that will move on to my next question, which is actually the other side of the coin of the first question. We'll go to Mr. Murphy. Does legislative experience matter? How will your experience help you to accomplish your goals and represent the citizens of Forsyth County?
Well, it absolutely matters. I mean, you know, I'm the 10th ranking Republican down there. That means something. That means you have influence. You know, with the leaders, you have influence with the governor. You know, that absolutely means something. So, you know, when you're chairman, when you're on rules, which is, no bill gets passed, no bill comes to the floor of the Senate without going through rules. I serve on rules. I've been on appropriations for 9 years. When I go asking for money for Forsyth County, asking for money for our libraries, asking for money for our driver license services building, asking money for our North Georgia College, I've got that money. I have raised that money. And they, you know, that gets done through, you know, your influence and your tenure down there. There is tenure, you know, not tenure, but there is something to be said for, you know, having served a long time. You do have some influence. You are able to talk to the right people. You do know who to talk to. It takes 4 years, almost 4 years, you to find out who you even talk to down there. And I mean, you know, kind of telling on myself, when I first got elected as a representative, I didn't even know hardly where the bathrooms were down there, much less how to pass a piece of legislation or get something done. So it does take a while to do that. It does take seniority to get a lot of things done, and most of it's based on seniority.
We just heard Jack talk about his seniority and how much influence he has down there. There's several of his supporters out there telling the same story. We need our senator down there because of all of his influence. Where's our roads? Where's our fair tax? Where's all these things he's been talking about for at least 2 years now? Do I think experience is important? Yes, I do, it's obvious. But what I'm gonna bring down there is a new level of energy, excitement, and a can-do attitude. Just being up here today, 8-9 months ago, nobody even knew who I was. I've been out there, I've been busting my butt, working hard, trying to build the steam and the momentum up there because of this message. I can take that same excitement and energy down to the state capitol. Am I going to accomplish things my first year down there? No, I don't believe that. But it's going to take a lot of time, a lot of effort, a lot of energy, and that's what I bring.
That's called seniority. It's going to take get anything done. There's a lot of pressure that comes in every year. You can pick up their brochures, you can pick up everything that they're going to do down there. There's, like I said, there's 236 legislators. Where would you start? Where would you start? Who would you start with to get these things done?
Wherever I need to. It's a matter of going down there and making it happen. Whenever I started my first business with sport clips, I was an accountant who was going to banks asking for money to start a business that was in the second highest failure industry in the country. I was laughed at most of the time, but I still found a way to make it happen. Just because it might be hard or difficult doesn't mean it's impossible.
And we're going to try to land this plane right at 8 o'clock to make it a 1-hour debate as promised. If the plane lands a minute or two over, just don't shoot me. But we do have a couple more questions that I think the voters would like to hear you guys talk about. In the last legislative session, State Senator Josh McCune sponsored a bill to require all legislation to sit on the desk of a state representative or senator for 24 hours after the final committee report of the bill. What do you think of this idea of allowing 24 hours to read final reports and get feedback from your constituents? And the question goes to
I absolutely support it. I think we need enough time to read every single bill that comes at our desk and get feedback from our constituents and other people that we trust. Whenever we try to push through legislation, we get stuff like Obamacare in front of us, and we do not want that. We need to be able to read our bills. And if toss out there.
I agree. We do need time to read the legislation, but in most cases, the bills have already been read. We've already looked at the bills before they ever get to our desk. It takes about 2.5 months to get a bill through the Senate or the House down there. So most likely we've already seen the bill, but I don't have a problem with them putting a bill on the desk 24 hours before it's passed or voted on. I mean, that might even help us out. That might slow down some of this legislation that is being put out there.
The next question will go to Mr. Murphy. Would you support changing Georgia election laws to a closed primary system in which voters would need to register as a member of a specific political party in order to vote for candidates of that party's primary election?
Yes, I don't have a problem with it.
Yes, sir.
We're going to wind this thing down on time. Last question before we go to your final closing statements. As a Georgia State Senator, what is your role in helping Forsyth County deal with local problems such as traffic, water, and infrastructure needs? Mr. Williams.
Can I start with that?
Who's it, Mr. Williams?
What is my role? Do you repeat?
Yep. As a state senator, what is your role, or what would be your role, in helping Forsyth County deal with local problems such as traffic, water, and infrastructure?
I feel like we would play a very important role in that. One, again, we've talked about traffic a lot tonight. It's going to be our responsibility to go down there to meet the people that we need to bring the money back up to Forsyth County. Again, talking about the way that we distribute the tax dollars, the fuel tax dollars, getting that changed. Negotiating the water contracts. I feel like we would play a very important role in making sure that the citizens of Forsyth County are represented and that their desires and needs are heard.
I think there's a lot of things that we can do behind the scenes, but this is a state senator position. It's not a commissioner's position. And there's only certain things we can do. By the way, I didn't have anything to do with the Castleberry Road project that you mentioned, Marco. That is a county road. It's not a state road. If we can get funding for some of our county roads, that we can get through some grants, like design grants, design money, half $1 million, $1 million to help the counties out on that, I would be more than glad to try to do that and have done that in many cases to try and get the funding for those. The water issues is an ongoing issue here in Forsyth County. It has a lot to do with the federal government. It has a lot to do with the Corps of Engineers and how they permit the withdrawal from the lakes and from Lake Lanier. And as long as we have a lawsuit going on with Florida and Alabama, Georgia is not going to release any more permits or withdrawal permits out of that lake. And that's been told to a lot of elected officials in this county over and over and over again. And whenever that's settled, maybe things will change and they can get withdrawal permits, you know, for the county.
Bunny?
Yeah, just a quick comment about his, he wasn't involved in the Castleberry Road. I recall a picture clear as day with him, Mark Hamilton, Board of Commissioners, a check for like $1 million. Are you just taking credit for something you didn't do?
You need to go back and look at that photo. I wasn't in it when they was holding that check for $1 million.
And with that, you decided to have the rebuttal to our final question. We'll move on to closing remarks. We open with closing remarks from Mr. Murphy. We'll open the closing remarks with Mr. Murphy. You have 2 minutes.
Again, I want to thank all of you for coming out tonight. It's been a pleasure. It's been fun. Thank you, Brad, and Forsyth County GOP, and also, Jack, thank you for being here tonight. You've heard a lot of different stories up here. I've said some things, he said some things, there's been some disagreement. I encourage every one of you to go home, to research them, and to figure out who it is that you want to vote for and support. I'm reminded, though, of, again, when I was running sport clips, they used to have candidates come up and interview. And they would give a great, great interview. They'd answer all the questions right, get excited about them. They'd come to show up for work. There's a completely different person showing up for work. 2 years ago, Senator Murphy said the same things that he's saying today. What's he going to do differently? Is he just up here talking, or is he just going to show up down there and do the job? I promise you today, next year, 2 years from now, that I'll be the same person as I am now and represent you and do the best I can to represent the citizens here in Forsyth County. Thank you again for coming out.
She was in the last election with me, so, and what Michael says is true. I've interviewed a lot of employees, and what he says is very true. And you know what, it works well with candidates as well. They come in saying they're gonna change the world. They're gonna change everything. They're gonna stop your taxes. You're not gonna have to pay any taxes. They're gonna change this, they're gonna change term limits, they're gonna improve the roads, they're gonna get all this funding, they're gonna do everything. Because it's in their brochures. But you guess what? It gets down there, and where the rubber meets the road down there is when you're sitting in your desk and you got a red button and you got a green button. And that one of those buttons has to be passed. You know, and that's where it comes to light on what the county's gonna do. So, you know, just look at my record. I have, you know, gotten money for the county, I've gotten money for the roads. I've done everything I can. I've lived in this county 30 years. And it doesn't matter. Some of the big things really doesn't matter about the taxes, the roads and all. It's what I can do for the individuals and my constituents in this county. Because, you know, I like helping people. When they come to me and they're having a problem getting their Social Security straightened out or getting something from the government that they're supposed to get and they're not getting it. Veterans comes to me all the time about problems that they've got, and I like referring those, and it gives me a great deal of pleasure to help those individuals out. That's what it's all about. It's not just about these big issues that we talk about, and we really can't do a lot about the federal issues. You know, we can send resolutions, we can beat our drums, we can do everything that we possibly can, but can we change it? You know, we're not going to change it until it comes in 2016. That's when we're going to change it, and that's when we're going to have to change it. But thank you for being here tonight, and I appreciate you coming.
With that, the Forsyth County Republican Party concludes its 2014 debate series. Luckily, there are no further extensions to the primary after this. But we know that July 22nd is your last day to vote. Don't just think of it as election day, it's your last day to vote for one of these two candidates, as well as a senatorial race and other local races. Please be sure to go out and vote. And also, please mark your calendars for the third Saturday of every month. Join your local Forsyth County Republican Party as we gather on the third Saturday of every month, 9 a.m. at the VFW. What you saw here today is just a small taste of what we do week in, week out, every month of the year. So we hope to see you there. And again, we thank both of our candidates. Let's give them one more round of applause.
Thank you.